Good morning. I'm Bruce Eckel. I'm here to introduce Renee Chu, who's going to be talking about unit tests, cluster tests, a comparative introduction. Take it away.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to my talk on unit testing and cluster testing. I'm Renee, and I currently work as an engineer at Pivotal Labs in San Francisco. So to give you some of my background, I became an engineer as an adult 3 years ago. And for my first few years, I worked at a company with a service-oriented infrastructure. So each individual team owned services that other teams rely on. A really valuable skill I learned was how to write cluster tests and what makes a good cluster test as opposed to what makes a good unit test. So what does that mean for you guys, and who's a good audience for this talk? Well, this talk is relevant to you if you have experience writing some software test. It won't cover the basics of why we test. And you've contributed a team, but you haven't owned a project and you haven't set up a testing suite. A lot of what we're covering today is what's good for coverage in each of the different layers of testing. So you can think of this as a testing 102. And just to make sure I know who I'm talking to, if this describes your level of experience, you have a couple, 1 or 2 years of experience, your experience with testing, please raise your hand. Okay. And if you are more senior than this level of experience, please raise your hand. Good to know. And if you're more junior, please raise your hand. Good to know. Okay. Thanks, you guys. So as far as this topic goes, why do those of you that raised your hand at the beginning need to know about these two types of testing? Well, it goes back to something that engineers know about our profession once we're on the inside, which is that engineers are lazy. We don't like repeating things. We don't like to be up at night. Ideally, we'd hand the car keys off to the robots, and they'd take care of everything while we relax on a beach somewhere. But at the same time, engineers are reliable. And this is something I learned when I became an engineer from the outside. I used to think being an engineer was all about being smart, that that's the biggest quality of an engineer. But the more I talked to actual engineers, the more I realized that reliability and follow-through are much more valued within the profession than pure smartness. So if we own something, we want to make sure that it works as much as we'd rather lie on the beach. So it's this intersection of characteristics, laziness and reliability, that are the heart of this talk and why you'd want to design a testing system with different layers of testing. Now, let's talk about you and your future job. Let's say you maintain a REST API for Twitter. So you can think of it as a bare-bones service that gets and posts tweets without the styling of the website. And I have no affiliation with Twitter. This is just an example from an interview problem I did long ago, so that's why I'm using the outdated 2008 logo from Twitter. And by the way, this service is written in Python using Flask, so it's called Pwitter. So what does Pwitter do? Well, if you hit the URL and specify a user, it hit the tweets endpoints, you'll see a user's tweets. Similarly, if you hit the same URL with a post request, you can make a new tweet. And you can only tweet if you're that user, so you have to supply your username and auth token. And you also have to pass in a post parameter, which is the body of the tweet itself. So we know that we have Pwitter, a service you can hit to view and post tweets. Who uses this service? Well, humans can use it. If you wanted to, you could just log into your terminal and curl and hit Twitter and post a tweet. So here's user, you'd hit the post request with your body, and then in the rest of the world, the next time someone logs into twitter.com, they will see your tweet. But as much fun as it is to tweet via API calls, humans are not the primary audience for this service. Usually, it's other services. So here we have the same flow. We have the user at the far left. We have the rest of the world on the far right, and Pwitter getting used to make the tweet. But instead of the user hitting Pwitter directly, they're logging into a website, submitting their content via form, and the form, the website, hits the Pwitter service for us. Or how about a mobile app for Twitter? Here the user types a tweet instead of in a website form into his or her iPhone, and the app makes the API request to Pwitter. The idea is Pwitter is agnostic to any programming language. It just receives and responds to requests, so many different clients can use it. So this is a service that other services depend on. What qualities does it need to have? Well, reliability is a top one. If our service goes down, it could jeopardize the whole user experience. And there's multiple types of reliability. There's uptime reliability. So Pwitter as a service can't be offline, because if the service is down, then the website is down, the mobile apps are down, or at least showing some degraded experience. We can aim to be up 100% of the time, or at least have a standard of being up 99% of the time, or 99.999, which adds up to less than slightly more than 5 minutes of downtime. And aside from being available as a service, we really care about correctness. So if your service is up, you want to make sure it's doing the right thing. So for example, a post to user A's account shouldn't add a tweet to user B's feed, and so on. Let's talk about uptime first. As a user, all I care about is that I can sit down, make a post request to Pwitter, and Pwitter will post a public tweet for me that I can eventually see when I view my page. I don't care about what happens inside Pwitter. In reality, Pwitter might be two pieces of software. We have the controller, which does all the business logic, and then we have the database, which stores the tweets and allows them to be fetched. In that case, what are the potential problems for the service not being up? Well, the machine that the controller is on could go down. The machine that the database is on could go down. Or both the controller and the DB machines could be fine, but some network connection between them could be lost. Any one of those scenarios could jeopardize our uptime. And at a really large-scale company like Twitter, there might be many different services. For example, one service just in charge of checking the username and password, one service just in charge of figuring out your location based on your Latin long on long. Companies break out into services to be able to scale horizontally, so we're talking about many different machines being contacted just to process one tweet. And there's also this concept of integration testing, which some of you might already be familiar with. So for example, if my controller for Pwitter first contacts the auth service to look up a user, and then contacts the geography service to figure out what his location is, it might not be working with two consistent data formats. So in this example, the auth service returns a response with date created being snake cased, and the geo service has date created being camel cased. The controller needs to know what response format to expect so it can process the data correctly, but it's not always in control of what format the upstream services are using. It's not always in control of when those services change. So it needs to continuously test that the intended actions can do what they expected to, regardless of underlying changes. So cluster tests are just there to make sure the service works, regardless of changes under the hood. You can think of cluster tests as an intern sitting in the basement of Twitter, logging on and making sure that you can still make a request, and then logging on to make sure that the service did what you expected to, over and over again. And you'd want to be the test to run continuously, making sure you can do the same thing every minute or so. Now, what about unit tests? Unit tests are different. They're definitely there to test correctness. Unlike cluster tests, which just thread the needle all the way through and make sure it works regardless of the internals, unit tests thoroughly track the internals and make sure every bit of code do what they say they do. They make sure every individual scenario is handled. So, for example, if we want to do a unit test for the part of the controller that just fetches a person's tweets, what is the logic that is underneath that controller first off. Well, in this example, if I'm getting someone's tweets, the first thing my controller does is it looks up the user's data, the user's username in the database of users. Then it takes the user's ID and looks up the tweets database to find all tweets that have that user ID. And it'll create an empty list of results and loop through all of the tweets and append them to that result list and return that result list. This is just an example of one simple implementation. And then because DB connections fail, you want to make sure that if those fail, they have an exception thrown. And also, if we look up a user that doesn't exist, then before we can return their tweets, we have to return an error saying that that user doesn't exist. So user cases are written in, or sorry, error cases are written in. What test cases do we want? Remember, we know that unit tests are testing every possible code path. So we want to test the happy path, or in our case, because zero tweets is the valid case, multiple happy paths, and all the error cases. If the DB fetches fail, you get the error that you expect. If the username doesn't return an error, you want to test that you get the error you expect so that upstream services know they're getting what they've been promised they will get. If you have a user with no tweets, you want to make sure that you are returning an empty list of tweets. The idea is to make sure that every nook and cranny of the implementation is tested. You don't want an end user to look up their friend that has zero tweets and get some strange error message or some strange display because you've only tested the happy path with multiple use cases. Unit tests help you sleep at night knowing that every scenario is handled. So every code repo has its own set of unit tests that are written side by side with the code. Developers run tests to make sure that if they add a new feature into that repo, they won't be adding that new feature and then break something in the new part of the code base. The unit tests cover every feature that's in that repo. And if your service is broken up into many different repos like this, the geography service, the auth service, has its own full set of unit tests that are run before a new feature is added to them. So some practical notes. Now that we've gone over the coverage philosophy, let's share some implementation details that flow from these philosophies. Where are unit tests, or are tests housed? Well, since unit tests have a lot of insight into the implementation details, they're in the same code repo as a service code. So as a developer is working on a feature, they can run those unit tests. But cluster tests are different. They're the intern in the basement. So they need to make sure that regardless of the underlying details, your service still works. They're housed in a completely different repo, running from a completely different machine as the software code. What about when tests are run? Well, in this black and white case, unit tests are run before you're merging in new code. They're the gatekeeper to make sure that new code doesn't add any new bugs. They're the ones that help developers make sure that their feature, their new code, is doing what it's expected to do. Cluster tests are different. Once the service is up and online, cluster tests are run continuously, and it doesn't matter when something is changing. The idea is that they're there, they should always be passing regardless of what's changing underneath the surface. A few other practical notes as you get started on building this out for your own services. Don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. I once heard advice from personal finance planning that you can put in 20% of the effort and it'll cover 80% of what you need. So in this case, if you're doing cluster tests and you want to cover, the get and the post case, but you can't cover the delete case, don't let that stop you from setting up cluster tests to begin with. If you just set up a couple of the use cases that thread all the way through, that gets you most of the way there and is certainly better than nothing. And also, too many tests is almost as bad as too few tests. You don't need to test every single possible input for your unit test. For example, you just need to test the happy path, the error cases, all the edges of your cases, but you don't necessarily need to test every single possible input that could come in if you're not getting different code coverage tested. So to bring it back to why we care about all this, there are the two types of reliability that we care about. On one hand, we care about uptime, making sure that if the service ever stops working, we know about it as soon as possible so that we can handle it. And on the other hand, as we change the features and introduce new code, we want to make sure that we don't introduce new bugs, that we catch those bugs before they get introduced into our live service. So to put these together, if we have the constant monitoring plus the unit tests that act as a gatekeeper, we get laziness. So if you have solid, well-organized tests, your team can sleep like a baby. Thank you.
Okay, we have time for some Q&A. I'm going to try and run down with the microphone. It's because it's being recorded, so if you do it on the microphone, everybody can hear it.
Hi, great job on the talk. I just have a question about cluster tests. So I gather from your discussion of them that they are to be run against the live code, like the live site. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, that's a really good question because I struggled with this as I planned out this mapping of the talk. There's cluster tests that refer to the integration testing side of things, and then there's the cluster tests that refer to the health of the system, the uptime side of things, and to be able to make it as black and white a world as possible, I lean towards the monitoring side of things. But at least at my company, we had cluster tests in stage and more minimal cluster tests in prod. And the cluster tests in stage were there really to test all the integration points. They were much more fulled out to make sure that any possible inconsistency would be caught in stage to make sure the services worked. And then the cluster tests in prod were more what I was referring to in this talk, just to make sure that things were working.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you.